I'm Dr. Keon West of the Institute of Psychological Sciences at the University of Leeds, and I'm going to talk today about explanations of prejudice. To talk about explanations of prejudice, I first have to talk a bit about what prejudice is. After that, I'll talk about realistic conflict theory, mostly to get it out of the way, because I don't think that's what we're talking about when we talk about prejudice, at least not in the layman's sense. Then I'll talk about four different theories, psychological theories, of why people are prejudiced that have nothing to do with realistic conflict. So, to begin, what is prejudice? It seems like a very simple concept, but prejudice is actually a bit hairy to define. Everyone agrees that prejudice involves differential group treatment. Work by other psychologists proposes that prejudice should be unfair as opposed to fair, although work by Chris Kandel helps us understand that maybe fair and unfair are again concepts that we're mixing up with the idea of what is prejudice and what isn't. It's very complicated, so I won't go into it too much, but for now we'll accept that it's in some way unfair or unreasonable, not just based on actual things that are going on. And this will become important a bit later on my other slide. And finally, psychologists like Beverly Daniel Tatum say that it's not just unfair, but it has to do with power relationships. So if you don't like a group of people, but they have all the power over you, that's still not prejudice, because no one cares what you think. Only if someone cares what you think does it actually count as prejudice. You don't have to agree with all of this, but try to understand it as a framework for what I'll be talking about later when we talk about why we have prejudices. So the first thing I'll talk about, just to get it out of the way, is realistic conflict. And this is exactly what it sounds like. Conflict between groups for resources that they really need. Resources, however, don't need to be concrete resources. They can be abstract resources. So you can have competition over who gets to be the more popular group, or who gets to be the ones in charge. They don't have to be physical things like food. And in fact, some people argue that these resources can be real or imagined. So it doesn't matter if there isn't any actual competition over actual food. If people think there's competition over food, that's enough to count it as realistic conflict. To represent that in a picture, you'll see that I have on one side blue circles and on the other side green circles. And in the middle, appearing there, are the tasty little resources, food or money or whatever it is, that they want to have. But there's not enough for both. There's only enough for one group or the other group. So that might make one group respond by attacking the other group or demonstrating intergroup bias, doing unpleasant things to the other group, so that the resources are then left for them, and suddenly there's enough for everybody.